unleashing enough energy to outshine galaxies.
Race up.
Supernovae are the most powerful explosions in the universe, unleashing enough energy to outshine galaxies. We have no real metaphor for their power. If the sun were to magically go...
So that's not true. I don't know why he started the video off with a false bit of information. They're not actually the most powerful, my friends. So Quasar's got them beat. Quasars, take that.
The other most powerful explosions in the universe.
Yeah, not quite. Not quite. Almost.
Unleashing.
You got things like hypernovae, which you don't want to be anywhere near. Potentially even as distant as 50,000 light years, and you could get somewhat fried. But yeah, quasars are technically explosions, right? Because you've got radiation exploding from the central supermassive black hole. It's just we don't usually describe it that way, right? So with an active galactic nuclei, which is what you have with a quasar, which is when you have the central supermassive black hole, the giant accretion disk that's glowing hot, it heats up as matter falls in and swirls, and it shoots off these giant beams of radiation perpendicular to the galaxy. And it's got multiple modes there. So you've got a quasar mode, you've got a radio mode, and the radio mode is like a bit, very different. But basically, yeah, it's an explosion. And, you know, the radio mode actually releases some radiation back within to the galaxy itself. And we think it can actually disturb the galaxy's star formation and things like this. Whereas the quasar mode, you know, is a bit more extreme and it's, you know, through the poles. And when these things pointed at us in the distant universe, early universe, because they don't actually occur anymore in our local modern universe. I say local modern, remember, because space and time are linked. So that means everything close to us is in our local universe and everything far away is in the early universe. And we only see these things in the early universe. It's a whole galaxy evolution thing, but anyway.
Enough energy to outshine galaxies. We have no real metaphor for their power. If the sun were to magically go supernova, it would feel like you were being hit by the energy of a nuclear explosion.
I've got a good metaphor for you. Just imagine a serious punch from Saitama.
Every second, for weeks. While supernovae are the engines of creation, forging the elements that enable life, they also burn...
How's the color match? The video.
There are whole regions of galaxies. So what would happen if one hit Earth?
It would be bad. If you want to see this in a lot of detail, because I covered this pretty extremely in the Halo video, of all things. What's up, Big Bang?
There are, roughly speaking, two ways to make a supernova. Either the core of a massive star implodes, or, less common, a white dwarf gains mass to the point where it ignites explosive nuclear fusion.
There are other ways, my friends.
The outcome is the same. A supernova...
What's the quote? And insert dark side quote from Star Wars.
Explosion. When we think of an explosion on Earth, we think of something that happens fast and ends. But a supernova is more like a volcanic eruption followed by a tsunami. At first, there's a colorful ball of hot, expanding gas.
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
Creating a spectacular cloud that will shine for about a month. But then, it doesn't stop. Hot and dangerous gas rushes outwards at speeds of 10,000 kilometers a second through the near vacuum of space, sweeping up the sparse gas of the galaxy. This wall of gas expands for tens of thousands of years and will eventually span up to dozens of light years until it finally cools off and disperses its substance back into the galaxy.
I was looking for my poster. I have a poster of the Crab Nebula, which is exactly what he's talking about. So if he doesn't show you, I'll show you.
So what if this star tsunami...
No, it's not a giant crab, okay?
...hits us? Well, the damage depends on how far away it is. Stage one, thousands of light years away.
Okay, before we let him go further into this, let me show you this crab. That is the remnants of a supernova explosion. And you can see, right, just what he was illustrating. And there is a crab in the center there. If you zoom in close enough, you'll see one of those pesky giant orange crabs. So that's why they called it the Crab Nebula. I'm kidding. In the center is a pulsar, and it is whipping around. If you view it in different types of electromagnetic radiation, right, you can see different things, and that's why you'll see different images of it. And then let me show you what this pulsar. It whips around, and you can actually see it a little bit here, because at the poles it shoots out this radiation and it whips around. And when that hits us, we call neutron stars pulsars.
Humans have witnessed dozens of supernovae, but all of them were thousands of light years away. They appeared as new stars, some outshining the moon, twinkling for a few weeks, and disappearing. Aside from looking very pretty at this distance, they don't do much to us. Stage 2, 300 light years away. Things begin to get a bit icky once a supernova occurs around 300 light years away. We can expect one this close to us every few million years. A single star giving the night sky an eerie glow like twilight.
All right, I better stop pausing. This is a long one.
And while this is far enough away and dim enough to not do harm to us, they can affect the Earth. At these distances, it's like being hit by the last weak waves of the star tsunami. Not strong enough to do real damage, but still noticeable. In fact, we know that over the past 10 million years, multiple supernovae have struck Earth from these distances because we can find radioactive isotopes of iron deep in the rocks and sediments at the bottom of the ocean. Amazingly, these supernovae around the solar system have cleared a 1,000 light-year wide pocket of space that's called the local bubble. They blew away the interstellar gas and dust, creating a lumpy wall of gas that's now a cradle for star formation. Stage 3.
Yeah, these things actually spur star formation. Obviously, if it's right next to it, it's going to halt star formation, but generally, this stuff explodes a lot of heavy elements back into the universe. That's where a lot of the heavy elements come from, dying stars. And, you know, there'll still be something left in the middle, either a black hole, neutron star. But anyway, that stuff that expands outwards, yeah, it actually spurs star formation.
Our cradle for star formation. Stage 3, 150 light years away. Once a supernova happens much closer than 300 light years, we're approaching the zone where it does real damage. Stars have extremely powerful magnetic fields. When they die, the tsunami of dead star actually retains a lot of this magnetic energy woven through the shockwave that expands outwards. In this highly magnetized cloud, we get conditions like in a huge particle accelerator that's accelerating charged particles like protons, nuclei, and electrons to immense speeds, which means we have an expanding cloud that is shooting deadly radiation in all directions long after the bright light from the initial explosion has faded away. If a supernova happens too close by, waves of these cosmic rays will wash over the solar system for thousands of years. While we're mostly protected on Earth's surface by the atmosphere and ozone layer, the influx of extra radiation will still increase cancer and mutation rates. Not enough to cause a mass extinction, but it...
So you got to wonder if, periods of intense mutation on the Earth, of rapid evolution, might have been spurred by supernova events. You got to think about it. Like, for instance, you know, why did our previous monkeys just start painting on caves one day? I know they're not monkeys. Smart primates, okay? You know, why did we start, modern humans, start drawing on caves? You know, at some random point, there's cave paintings, and then before that, there's nothing. And then there's lots of examples of these sorts of things. And, you know, who knows if evolution is actually spurred by an increased rate of mutations whilst, you know, they're going about their business and natural selection is doing its thing. Maybe you could even define a new law of evolution. Maybe not a law, but something intense, right, where you need supernova events within your vicinity at a certain frequency to spur rapid evolution. I'm just completely speculating. You should come download KelVPN, which is a post-quantum VPN, the first in the world, the only one that can protect you from quantum computers right now. We made it. I made it. You should come get it. It's friggin' majestic. Look at all these servers. We're about to release the Mac version as well as the Linux and then the mobile apps. So if you want to follow my journey, you know, I'm physics background, journeying into computing and entrepreneurial stuff, come check it out.
Will be noticeable. Spaceflight would become impossible in the solar system as astronauts wouldn't survive the waves of radiation for long. We don't know exactly how bad this would be, but a supernova that is close enough may trap our species on Earth for generations, maybe thousands of years. Oh, it only gets worse from here.
Oh yeah.
Stage 4, closer than 100 light years. Within 100 light years, things
I wonder if we're going to talk about some larger things as well, like hypernova.
Bad, as a supernova disrupts our climate in ways that we don't fully understand yet. There are a few unpleasant things happening all one after another. First, the high-energy photons arrive from the explosion, followed by many decades of radiation from the radioactive tsunami, both of which seriously damage the ozone layer, Earth's shield against harmful radiation.
I feel like that's a term Kurzgesagt has found, coined, radiation tsunami. I don't think I've really seen that many other places.
The ozone layer absorbs ultraviolet radiation by breaking apart ozone, O3, into O2 and a free oxygen atom, which later reforms back into another ozone molecule. But the supernova radiation breaks up nitrogen molecules that gobble up the free oxygen, breaking the cycle and depleting the ozone layer quickly. Without a radiation shield, everybody living on the surface is exposed to very high levels of UV radiation from our sun. Cancer rates would skyrocket, and just going outside during the day could be life-threatening. The extra radiation would also kill a lot, if not most.
Just if you thought the pandemic was bad, and it couldn't get any worse, my friends, it could get worse.
Most of the plankton in the oceans that live near the surface and are the basis for the marine food chains, leading to a mass extinction. Worse still, supernova radiation would ionize gas in the atmosphere, which means that it would punch through molecules and knock electrons off.
Do we need another reason to keep funding science so we can learn how to, like, you know, combat this sort of thing?
Nuclei, leaving them charged. These charged nuclei then act as seeds for water vapor to gather and form massive global clouds. In the worst case, they would reflect enough sunlight to trigger an ice age. In fact, it's thought that the ice age 2.5 million years ago was caused by a supernova. Some scientists even think that a supernova about 60 light years away might have been the cause of the Devonian.
Yeah, I can't remember, but you guys ever heard of Snowball Earth when the Earth was literally covered in glaciers? I wonder if, you know, supernovas played a role there.
Mass extinction 350 million years ago. But wait, there's more. The electrons punched free by the radiation form enormous electric avalanches, or in other words, lightning.
Electric avalanches.
Earth is hit by some of the worst thunderstorms in millions of years. The intense lightning causes global wildfires that consume forests and crops, devastate cities, disrupt our electrical grids and global supply chains. All while a decimated ozone layer leaks deadly radiation. While in the past the ecosystem may have bounced back from a nearby supernova after a few thousand or million years, there's no guarantee modern civilization can take a hit of this magnitude.
Yeah.
We would face food.
It could be very bad, especially with our electrical grid and
food shortages, skyrocketing prices, and wars as nations struggle to not be consumed by chaos. So a supernova this close would at the very least do significant damage for hundreds or thousands of years, if not end our modern civilization, and with it millions or even billions of lives.
Could be bad.
Still, humanity would likely survive and could recover.
Maybe.
Stage 5, closer than 25 light years.
Okay.
A supernova closer not than good. 25 light years means that we're in its kill radius, where a mass extinction is all but guaranteed. Probably about half of the ozone layer would be destroyed, and massive climactic disruption on a scale we've never witnessed would ravage Earth.
Yeah.
Entire ecosystems would swiftly be wiped out by radiation as global wildfires envelop the planet. All the things described before happen, but way more intensely and much faster. A few people might survive for years in bunkers if they have food supplies, but the world they return to will be devastated and hostile to life for hundreds of thousands of years. Human extinction is extremely likely. The final stage, 4 light years. Being any closer to a supernova is very unlikely because space is big, but the effects would be extreme. Even from 4 light years away, the distance to Alpha Centauri, a supernova would be almost as bright as the sun in the sky. While casting two shadows could be fun for a few hours, within days the Earth's surface gets as hot as a sauna, baking the surface for weeks until the explosion fades. The surface of Earth...
And it gets worse. Like, you thought this was bad, right? This is just your typical supernova boy, right? You get things like hypernovas, which are rarer, of course, but they exist. And I said 50,000 light years before, but I take that back. I'm pretty sure it's actually about 25,000 years at the point where it could be in... close enough to actually significantly change our climate, which could mean, you know, end of advanced civilization. And I'm pretty sure it's about 25,000 light years. And our galaxy is only 100,000 light years across. You only need four of these things spaced out. And, you know, you can kind of wipe, not wipe out life, but maybe advanced life. Just in case you guys were wondering how to wipe out all sentient life in a galaxy, now you can do it, all right? So, yeah, it would be very bad. You'd get a lot of smog in the atmosphere as well. Anyway, let's keep going.
Burns scoured of life. Even the oceans aren't safe. The massive amount of radiation that follows burns away the ozone layer, killing everything that sees sunlight. It would be the largest extinction event in history, reducing life to a few survivors in the deep sea and critters in the deep soil. Life basically has to start over.
Already in the largest mass extinction event, if you didn't know.
Conclusion. How worried do you need to be?
Not very worried.
So, should you worry? No. Fortunately, there are...
I feel like that's always the answer in Kersey's Ark videos. Don't worry, though. It's fine. Well, after telling you, you know, 8 minutes of how catastrophic it would be.
Only a handful of stars that may explode within 1,000 light years of Earth, and none are close enough to be a serious threat.
If we think. We're pretty sure.
Even better, these stars will probably not go supernova for many millions of years.
You might be wondering why I say that. Obviously, from what we understand, yes. But you got to remember, our understanding of stars, what's going on within stars, is not very good. You know, but look, we can observe a lot of stars in the sky. We seem to have this stuff pretty down, so don't worry. But, you know, like our sun, for instance, it's got all weird things that happen, and we don't understand it with its 11-year cycle and the poles flipping. We don't know what's going on. But anyway, we think we understand stars.
So you are safe. But there's no guarantee for the far future. As stars orbit the galaxy, our descendants may find themselves dangerously close to a supernova. But by then, a far more advanced and wiser humanity will hopefully be able to just...
The Kaplan drive, huh? They hired someone, an astrophysicist, to design this in another video. Go check it out.
Move out of the way. In any case, you can sleep well tonight, under the beautiful night sky. And if you dream about understanding the physics behind this video and others,
come watch my channel. Anywho, that is another Kersey's Ark video, and he was just telling you to come subscribe to my channel, so if you haven't already. But it's saying that with that all my previous videos, because going forward, we're actually kind of transitioning. No, I'm not, you know, turning into a woman. I'm saying our channel is turning into a woman. No, I'm kidding. It's going through a midlife crisis, and we're changing. We're expanding our horizons.